Welcome to the India FinTech Diaries, the only podcast focused exclusively on the Indian FinTech market. I'm Elroy.
And I'm Hemant. In each episode, we dive into the latest trends, ideas, innovations, business models, and personalities that are shaping India's FinTech landscape.
We also invite amazing guests who are innovators and industry players that are driving the change that is helping make financial services more modern, innovative, and inclusive in India. Come join us as we explore the changing landscape of FinTech in India.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to a brand new episode of India FinTech Diaries. I'm your co-host Hemant, and this is our show where we discuss the latest trends in Indian FinTech and speak to some amazing guests from the industry and dive deep into specific FinTech themes.
And I'm your co-host Elroy. Last week, we announced a brand new theme called FinTech for Bharat that looks at how FinTech is aiming to be more inclusive in India. As per the 2011 census, India is home to a mind-boggling 121 languages, with 22 of these being recognized official languages. With such a vast variety of languages, how do fintechs effectively reach the masses in India? To answer this question and throw some light on the problem, we have a very special guest on the show today. I am pleased to welcome Arvind Pani, co-founder and CEO of Reverie Language Technologies, to the show. Welcome to India FinTech Diaries, Arvind.
Thank you, Elroy. Thank you, Hemant. It's my pleasure to be here.
Arvind, I'm intrigued by the name Reverie. It's quite an unusual name for a fintech. Talk to us a little about yourself and how Reverie came to be.
Yeah, sure. So just a clarification that we are a language technology company, and our technologies have application in fintech, and they have application in other domains as well. But the name is, you are right. So the name is unusual. And there is actually no big story behind it. When we were brainstorming about this, about what to name, one of the friends came up with this name of Reverie, and we liked it. And that is how we started. So just a quick introduction about myself and the background to how we started. I am one of the founders of Reverie. There are two other founders who joined me in starting this. We started Reverie Language Technologies way back in 2009, November. So it's been 11 years since we have been in this journey. And it's quite interesting that today people are actually talking about inclusion, and it's quite heartening to see that languages is very much at the heart of the inclusion discussions that are happening today. But back then in 2009, that was not the case. The only digital medium which was there, or the digital channel mobile, was primarily used for voice communication. And the only other thing that was available was SMS. Okay. But even at that time, in 2009, we were starting to see two trends. One was mobile phone was no more niche. It was starting to get into the hands of the masses. That was trend one that we saw. The second trend that we saw at that time was smartphones were just about kind of coming into being. For example, Apple had its first version of iPhone. Android had its first version of commercial version of operating system, which was Gingerbread. Gingerbread, in fact, came in the year 2011. So they had the first version, which was Froyo. So we noticed that even simple text communication, like through SMS and all, it was not possible in local languages. And even if there were very few mobile phones, even if they supported typing text in local languages, the recipient's phone did not necessarily have the ability to display those texts in Indian languages. So we realized that if mobile phones have to get into the hands of masses and it has to be inclusive, then there is no way Indian languages could be left out. So that is what we started with. We started building display and input capabilities for mobile phones, the operating systems, various operating systems. In fact, we were the first company in the world way back in 2011 to support all Indian languages on Android through our partnership with Qualcomm. And it is not just for Indian languages. We actually have supported about 35 languages on Android on all the Qualcomm reference design phones that came into the market at that time. And those included Indian languages and also several South Asian languages. So that's how we started. And then after a certain point, when mobile phones, government of India also mandated about three, four years back that anybody who is doing business in India, mobile manufacturers, mobile brands, they need to have support for at least the 22 official languages, display capability for those, and input capabilities for three languages, English, Hindi, and the regional language, the region in which the phone is selling, right? So after that, we started building our capabilities in into once the infrastructure, which is your display and input capabilities are there, then what different we could do on building the language experience itself when users start engaging through various things. So for government services, for banking services, right, any kind of digital services, how they can use that seamlessly in their languages. So that's how we have expanded what we started with into really focusing on how various aspects of user engagement can be available in Indian languages.
That's a very fascinating introduction, Arvind. Switching gears a little, let's talk about the problem. Now, today, if I look at it, 9 out of 10 Indians on the internet are non-English speakers, and this number is only growing. And this is a very recent survey that Google did that also indicated that almost 90% of new internet users today consume content in regional languages. But if I actually look at digital banking today, I think I'll be hard-pressed to even find a single bank that has a very good example of Indian language support within their banking interfaces. So why is this, and what's really stopping financial services from providing good inclusive interfaces in Indian languages?
I will actually address this at a little broader level. Now, sometimes what we are discovering right now, that 9 out of 10 people prefer Indian languages, these are actually not new things. These are some of the things. So which means what I'm trying to say here is that the demand for Indian languages has always been there. It is not that the demand is new on the internet. I will tell you why I'm telling this. If you take any media, see, and I will also connect it back to our vision. Our vision is to have language equality on internet in India. Now, what I mean by equality, that's where real the problem lies. You take any conventional media before internet. You take print, you take radio, you take television, you take cinemas, right? If you take all of this media, in all of this media, without exception, more than 90% of the engagement actually happens in Indian languages, not in English. The reason for that is the users in Indian languages, they do not have to do anything different to be able to engage in their content compared to what the English language users have to do. It is as intuitive. It is as simple. Say, for example, if I need to subscribe to, I'm from Odisha. If I need to subscribe to Odia newspaper, right? I can go to my newspaper vendor and say that you can give me an English edition and you can give me an Odia edition. That's all I need to do. As easy as that. If I need to watch Odia channel on television, I just need to flip. And from, let's say if I'm watching English from there, I need to switch to Odia, I can do that. But that is not the case when we are talking about internet. Unfortunately, what has happened is our internet itself got built for niche audience. It got built for English users, right? So that is where there are two barriers that we are really creating for the users, Indian language users. First and foremost, most of these users, they are new to technology itself. So when I say technology, that means, let's say a touch-based device, how to navigate, how to use it. That is one barrier. The second barrier is that when that entire navigation is in English language, then it's very difficult for someone to really figure out how to use it. So the learning curve, the curve to adapt and get there is massive. So one problem is that we never actually focused on how digital channels in India ground up in terms of their experience can be designed for Indian language users. They are unfortunately designed for English language users, right? And then the second thing is that the decision makers and influencers who are there, who take decisions, they're all English speaking. So whatever they perceive as problems about the Indian language users are only their assumptions. They are more often than not, they are not reality. The reason I'm saying is that they have not lived those problems day in and day out, right? And the result is really stark. If you look at the growth of internet in India and China started happening around the same time, okay? And the choice in front of both India and China were the same. Content first got created in English language. So even for China, the choice was that whether we start accepting the internet in English and then adapt it for Chinese language, or we say, no, we are not going to accept the internet in English. We will build our own internet in our language, which is the path that China took, right? The path that India took was we actually built the internet for English users. And now we are trying to adapt to Indian language users. So fundamentally, this is where the major barrier that is that's really coming.
Arvind, those are some really good insights. I think one of the key takeaways from your description right now of the problem is the fact that we've been designing things to be English first. I just want to understand from your experience, what are some of the unconscious design biases you start seeing in user interfaces when the design is English first rather than being some other Indian language first?
Okay, I will give you, what I will do is I'll try to draw analogy from the physical world to the digital world. That will probably make it very simple to understand, right? Now, in India, we say Atithi Devo Bhava. That means our guests are our God. We treat guests to be divine. If they are at our doorstep, then we do everything that's possible to make them feel very welcome. Okay, now let's translate that into, say, in branch banking. What happens in branch banking? In branch banking, there is nothing written that you can enter the branch only if you know English, right? So language is not a barrier there. If I'm in Bhubaneswar, I can walk. I'm from Odisha. I can walk into the branch of my bank, and actually, I can start talking in Odia, and my relationship manager will understand Odia. I can mention all my requirements, whatever I need, whether it is, say, check deposit, whether it is funds transfer, my statement, everything that I need to communicate and get would be in my language. Now, let's try to see what has happened in digital. Okay, there is one big initiative that has happened is India has tried to link every citizen through their Aadhaar identity, okay? And now it's a huge success where there are more than 1 billion people who have Aadhaar card today. Couple of years back, 2 or 3 years back, there was an initiative to really link the PAN card to Aadhaar. And there are multiple messages that have come to us to link that. I have not seen one message coming to any user in a language other than English. Every single message was in English. The entire linking process of Aadhaar and PAN card was in English, right? Then demonetization happened. The demonetization forms were all in English, okay? Today, if we go to, these are a couple of examples that I give. Then today, if we go to our internet banking or mobile banking, and we look at what are the things that we can do over there, okay? Now, if I look at my mobile banking screen, it says view account summary, write pay list, transfer funds, generate ATM pin, bill payment, credit card payment. All of these things are there in English language. Now, tell me if today someone has to do mobile banking or internet banking, how are they going to navigate through this barrier? So you can clearly see that the experience level of what we are talking about in branch banking is very different from the experience level that the banks are delivering today in internet banking or digital banking. That is the reason why even today, about 55% of the customers are very uncomfortable using any of the digital channels, and they prefer to go to the branches to do their banking. This is also one of the reasons why we are seeing huge amount of online fraud, because there is no awareness. The awareness, all the information that is supposed to create awareness, they are in English. So because of this lack of awareness, people do not know how to use digital properly. So most of the fraud that happens are in the category of these vulnerable people who don't understand English and therefore are not aware of how to secure themselves from these kind of frauds. So to just summarize, our thinking has not really been about delivering a totality of experience, okay, which we does not rely on English at all. And how can we replicate the same experience? How can we make the customers feel as welcome as they feel in branch banking experience?
Understood, Arvind. And Arvind and Elroy, thanks to both of you. Now that you have really laid it out of the different barriers and the specific problem statement that we have, Arvind, now I would like to bring it back and link it to the work that Reverie is doing. So if you can help us understand that, now we clearly understand this is the problem statement and this is the vision that Reverie has. How are you working towards it? What are the different solutions or use cases that you're working upon to really attack this problem at the base?
Yeah, sure, Hemant. So what I will do is I will tell about what the solutions are and how they can be applied to, say, banking. At the same time, I will also outline how we can think about this at the level of experience. See, one challenge today that's happening is that we are looking at solving this problem in bits and pieces and we are looking at technology, right? It's not a technology problem alone to solve. It is a user engagement problem to solve. So let me first tackle what I mean by that and how, what perspective as a technology company we have taken to this. Now, even though we are a language technology company, we understand that the fundamental problem that needs to be solved is of engagement experience in Indian languages. So the approach that we have adopted is that we would like to address every single aspect of users' digital journey, which they are able to do today in English language very comfortably, seamlessly, they should be able to do the same thing in Indian languages. What that means is that the process of customer acquisition, right? Today, if it is in English language, the same process can be followed in Indian languages without having any dependency on English language. Now, once a business has acquired a customer, let's say a bank has acquired a customer, all the transaction messages, statements, promotions, information related to awareness, all of those things can be in local languages, right? So that's what we mean by totality of the experience. Now, one fundamental thing that the banks can really do is that to capture what is the preferred language of communication of the user. It's not very difficult. I think we have not made an attempt. What is the reason that every time we make a call to customer care, that we have to go through the same menu, that one for English, two for Hindi, three for this, four for that? That's not required. Now, once as a user, if my language is Odia and it is recorded by my bank that I prefer my communication in Odia language. So every time I make a call to the customer care, automatically I get to speak with someone who knows Odia. The IVR starts speaking to me in Odia language, right? If I do an ATM transaction, then messages come to me in Odia language. The statements that come to me every month in my email, that can come to me in Odia language, right? If I download my application from the bank and I register, then my entire UI should be in Odia language. So these are some of the things that I'm talking about that will give totality of experience. And I would really urge all the decision makers to think along the lines of, one, how do you completely eliminate a dependency on English? And second, how do you deliver totality of the experience? Now, what I mean by that is, if a user is having to think about language while using a specific service, language in the sense the problem of language and how to solve it, then obviously the experience is not great. And going back to the earlier example that I gave, when we are watching TV, we are not thinking about how do I solve the problem of viewing my channel in my language. Okay, it is seamless. It is second nature. It is intuitive. We know how to do it. That is how the decision makers need to think, that how the entire engagement experience can be that seamless the way it is for English language users.
Understood. And Arvind, say, as a bank, now I have understood the way I need to approach the entire engagement or user experience of my customer, and I'm convinced and I want to do it. Now, the question I have seen a lot of banks face, and not only banks, but other financial services face, is I have multiple customer touch points, right? I have SMSs, I have my website, I have my IVR, I have my documents, I have my paper forms, in fact, the physical forms. And I want to give that experience, all that experience in, say, a regional language or Indian language to my customers. Now, from implementation point of view, how does Rivery help a bank attack this problem?
When you are looking up about this touch points, you can actually break it down into two. One is that what are the kind of nature of content that are there, right? For example, your website has got content, informative content. Your app has got informative content, and also for transactions, right? Now, how do I focus on having all my content which are there, which are either informative content or transactional content, including your SMSs and statements, be available in local languages? And Rivery has got the technologies to be able to handle both static as well as dynamic content. Rivery has got technologies to publish websites in multiple languages. So content becomes one piece of it, right? Whenever a content is generated and that needs to be disseminated to the consumer, that needs to be available in local language. That's one side of it. The second one is really how do you enable multiple channels of communication for the user in local language? So if a user wants to have a text-based communication, let's say maybe a bot where text communication is there, how that can be in local language. Now, if a user is more comfortable engaging in a voice channel, right, then how do you deploy voice technologies there? How could be your entire customer service, your IVR response be in local languages where voice will support that? Now, and the third aspect of it is that when a customer continues to engage with the bank, right, now, at every touch point where an interaction between the customer and the bank that happens, there is a need for interpreting what the customer really wants. Let's say a customer says that I want a new checkbook, and this is something, mujhe naya checkbook chahiye. Okay, this is what is a query, whether it is through text or through voice. And at the back end, it is technology which is supposed to interpret this and fulfill the customer's requirement, right? So the ability to understand the language in which the customer is speaking and translate that back into how technology can understand, and therefore responding appropriately to fulfill the requirements of customer. So these are the three aspects of delivering the totality of user experience. Summarizing, one, how can content, every aspect of content be available in local language, whether it is static or dynamic? Second is how can be the interactive touch points with my customer, whether it is through text or through voice, be available in local languages. Third is that how do I continue to interpret what the customer wants and respond appropriately in local languages. So if we are addressing these three aspects, every single aspect of the user's digital journey will fall under one or more of these three categories. That's how I would like to suggest that this problem needs to be looked at.
Understood. And Arvind, forgive my ignorance if the question is incorrect, but the second question I have is, when I have so many channels, and in some cases I may have an existing vendor in place, right? For example, you talked about chatbot, and I may have a chatbot which may not support, say, a regional language, and I have other contents as well. So that's one part. And the second part is, because I have so many platforms and so much content gets created, and say I start offering support in 14 or 15 Indian languages, ensuring that the content across all those languages is consistent, considering it is a regulated environment for financial services, right? Any mismatch between two different content could be problematic. So how does that problem get solved?
So very good question, this is. And again, technology will have a play here. Now, to be able to maintain, we have a platform which is content publishing platform for websites, which is called Anuvada. And that ensures that there is integrity of content, because we are assuming that the source content will always be in English, and then that eventually will get created in other languages, right? So whenever Anuvada ensures that whenever there is a change to the source content in English language, downstream changes are also also applied to other languages. So that is one aspect of maintaining the integrity of it. Second one is, how do we ensure that these kind of content which have got regulatory compliance as well, how are those met properly? That is actually a process question. Now, if we have certain content, we can put a process where once there is a change to content or a new content that has been published for English language, that will automatically trigger an action that is required for other languages, right? And whether that is immediate, if it is not, say, a regulatory compliant kind of a content, then the timeline for getting that content up and running in other languages could be shorter. If there is a kind of a check that needs to be done, then we can include that process. That may increase the time to make that content up and running a little bit. So we also have a platform where there are manual verifications that are required. And this platform is also backed by our technology. Of this platform is called Pravanda, where if there are any kind of content that requires any manual verification, it can go through that. And then after that, after the verification, it will get published. So it is not a very big challenge. Again, in this, I would like to really the banking decision makers to really think about the fact that what would we do if we did not have English customers at all? Would we not address the other customers? If we would do that, then there are definitely ways in which we can do that. Okay. And English is a relatively new language in India. English came into India when Britishers started ruling us. They introduced the system of English education so that they could effectively rule us. But that does not mean that the system that British designed that was effective to rule us is still the effective design for independent India. So if we had information available to us in our languages before English was introduced to us by British, why can't information be available to us now in our languages? We just have to make that start. It's not that complicated a problem to solve.
Makes sense. And Arvind, if say a bank or a financial institution wants to avail these services from Reverie, what are the different cost levers or cost elements which will come into picture when they decide to partner with Reverie?
So apart from cost, there is another factor which I will also mention. See, first and foremost, these are all usage-based, okay? And if the usages are low, then obviously the cost would be low. And as usages increase, the cost will increase. This is a typical usage-based model for everything that we are providing. So for content, for voice, right? Any service that we have that we are providing, any product that we have that is SaaS-based, we have that kind of a model. The other important aspect, especially for banks, where security and data confidentiality is of paramount importance, we have seen that banks prefer to have these deployments within their infrastructure, right? And that is also a mode in which we make our products available to entities where data security and privacy is kind of utmost importance, and they don't want data to be exposed to public clouds.
One last question, Arvind, from my side. What is the best anecdotal story that you have of the impact of this Indian language implementation that you have seen across your implementation?
I will actually take the one which is very recent, and it's kind of an eye-opener. See, when last year this coronavirus pandemic happened, it was essential for information to reach the nook and corner in their languages. So at that time, nobody even thought that in India we could reach out to everyone in just in English, or for that matter, just in one language. So there are a couple of initiatives where Reverie has contributed with massive impact. One is initially when our Prime Minister's messages were there in Hindi languages, we used our technologies to really have those messages available over voice. So in 8-9 other languages, and these were very widely circulated, including in Indian Army, and those were kind of very effective. The second initiative was around telemedicine helpline, because something like this had never happened, and it was new. People were confused. There were information that were required. So telemedicine helpline were set up in several states. And the process that was being adopted was that for telemedicine helpline, the IVR recording, a normal manual process would be that you record, a voiceover artist would really record those in a studio. And then it is made up and running for IVR telemedicine helpline. Now, for a very small script, IVR script, it used to take between 72 to 96 hours to really make that up and running. And having time was luxury. Time, we just could not afford to have so much time. So using our technology where we generated this voiceover, both in male as well as female voices, and those were as natural sounding as a human voice. And we made this IVR ready. And we reduced the time from 72 to 96 hours to really 3 to 4 hours. We used to make all of these IVR scripts ready within 3 to 4 hours. And that has been deployed in, I think, at least 9 or 10 states.
Excellent, Arvind. It's been great talking with you today. So let's say an audience wants to get in touch with you to learn more about Reverie. What's the best way to do this?
I can give my email ID. My email ID is arvind.pani@revereeinc.com. arvind.pani@reverieinc.com. So this is my email ID, and our website is also there. And people are most welcome to write to me directly.
Excellent, Arvind. We'll definitely add those details in the show notes of this episode. That's it from India FinTech Diaries this week. Do visit our website, indiafintechdiaries.com, for show notes, episode archives, and exclusive content. Thank you for listening, and until next time, stay safe.